can it be any more clear? Do you know what suffering does for most of us? It becomes our excuse for not being persistent. Our suffering becomes our excuse for not staying faithful. Because God doesn't work.
Come on.
The way we want him to work. There's so many profound things said there before we get into the gospel. I want to say something. How do you respond to suffering? Emotional, mental, physical. Do you press in and press on, or do you withdraw and stop? Mm-hmm. Or do you go back to what you know, or keep pushing into what is mystery? Beloved, listen to me. What she said about two types of justification, persistent faith means I'm going to keep being faithful as I go forward, not I'm going to be faithful and hope it works.
Come on.
So we have to understand in Christ's presence, persistent faith isn't, well, you know, I did my best and I tried, but I have other things that I need to do. Persistent faith says, my priority is constantly changing to my walk in covenant with God. Yes. It has top priority.
Amen.
My walk with God has top. And see, when you walk with a community that makes that top priority, you're going to always feel controlled if it's not your top priority.
That's right.
If God isn't your top priority, but it's your community's top priority, you're going to feel, well, why is everybody telling me I have to be here and do that?
Come on.
That's right.
Come on.
Because we want you to experience persistent faith.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So get over yourself. Get over yourself. Because yourself is what's messing you up.
Come on.
The church isn't messing you up. You are messing you up. And while I'm on the subject, God uses the imperfect, flawed church with flawed
That's
people,
right.
with flawed members to produce only what the church can produce.
Come on.
And that's the flesh and blood of God. And without what only the flawed church can produce, you have no life in you.
That's Amen. Right.
So get over what's wrong with other people while you're at it.
Come on.
Because criticizing other people is an act of selfishness.
Yes, it is.
And self-centeredness. Our judgment of other people's behavior has nothing to do with our own holiness.
That's right.
Nobody can defile you.
Come on.
Nobody can defile you by what they say or do. Only you can be defiled by you not understanding the church is flawed but perfect in the eyes of God.
Yes. Come on.
Does that help anybody there? Does anybody get help there? That helps me. Amen. Let's read the gospel. This is the Holy Gospel on the third Sunday of Lent, our Lenten journey. According to St. John, it's kind of long, so don't get bored and don't get distracted. Jesus came to the city of Samaria called Sychar, near the field of Jacob, that Jacob gave his own son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and so Jesus, wearied as he was with his journey, sat down beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. That would be noon, okay? There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" First of all, Jews are not supposed to talk to Samaritans. Neither are rabbis supposed to talk to women. So he stepped outside the orthodox of understanding there. "For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself and his sons and his cattle?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. The water that I shall give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst nor have to come here and draw again." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and he whom you are now living with is not your husband, that you said truly." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, not in emotion and intellect." Get that. I added that. That's Bishop Gregory translation. "And those who worship him must worship him in spirit, in truth." In other words, I must have a spirit of worship, not a spirit of resentment.
Come on.
And truth. Or obligation. They will not worship. Jews worshiped out of obligation, but those that worship Jesus worship him out of true spirit of unity. The woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah is coming. He was called the Christ. When he comes, he will show us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." Just then his disciples came. They marveled that he was talking with the woman. And when that word marvel doesn't mean they go, "Oh my gosh." It was like, "What are you doing talking to this woman?" And he said, "What do you wish?" Or, "Why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and went away into the city and said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the city and were coming to him. Meanwhile, the disciples besought him, saying, "Rabbi, eat." But he said to them, "I have food to eat of which you do not know." So the disciples said to one another, "Has anyone brought him food?" Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Do you not say, 'There is yet 4 months, then comes the harvest'? I tell you, lift up your eyes and see how the fields are already white with harvest. He who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, 'One sows and another reaps.' I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor." So the woman ran into the city and said to them, "Come and see the man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" So many out of the city were coming to him. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me all that I ever did." So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of your words that we believe, but for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world." Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Happy are they who hear these words, believe them, and obey them.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, speak to us today, not as babes or infants or adolescents, but as mature, that our homes may become stable and full of peace, that our lives may become stable and empowered with your grace to overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You know, for years, the church was big on testimonies, because we wanted to tell what God did for us. But there is no testimony without a test, and there is no message without a mess. So, as we learned in Friday's day of decrease, we have to fast from this halo Jesus, this well-manicured, coiffured, beautiful, shiny, squeaky clean Jesus that we want to come and make our life squeaky clean. He's a kingdom life is messy business, and it's testing business. It's not a place of convenience and comfort. It's not a place of escapism. It's a place of overcoming and endurance. Because we know we need to have a conference called the Boasting in My Suffering Conference. Because as long as I'm complaining about my suffering, I'm testing God. That is what happened in the Old Testament. They quarreled because they didn't have what they wanted or what they thought would fix their thirst. So they complained against Moses. And actually the word says that their quarreling tested God. This is why they could not enter the promised land, is because they complained about their testing. The testing was to produce character and to produce an understanding of who God is in their lives. But most of us, when we get tested or challenged, our carnal response is to withdraw, complain, criticize, and quit. Withdraw, complain, criticize, and quit. That's why the divorce rate is what it is. In every marriage, there's a mess that's being tested. In every family, there's a mess that's being tested. And as long as there's complaining and pointing of the finger, there's going to be more testing from God. It's not going to make the... Talking about your problem is going to enlarge your problem, not remove it. When you cease to talk about your testing and complaining, because when you hear someone complain, it always is going to boil back to self-protection and self-interest. How does this affect me? But yet we believe that it is no longer us that live, but Christ who lives. Great success is on the other side of enduring testing from God. He is supposed to test us, not us test him. And so we see in here in the collected day, keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Even the Son of God. How many of you believe that if you're a believer, sincere believer, you're a son of God? After God told Jesus, "This is my beloved Son," immediately the Holy Spirit drove him to the wilderness to be tested of the devil. The indictment on the church is not whether they have faith for blessing. The indictment on the church is whether they have endurance for testing. How do most people who claim Christianity deal with adversity? Do they stay persistent in their faith? Do they stay persistent in their resistance? Or do they back away, withdraw, isolate, and say, "I don't want to be a part anymore"? First of all, you need to understand the church is Christ. And we see in today's gospel some very telling things. The Christian life is pressing in, not backing off, and pressing on, not quitting. Press in and press on, not back off and quit. There is not a quitter spirit in the Spirit of God. Holy Ghost will never tell you to quit anything. Amen? Well, I heard that. He won't even tell you to quit sin. What he will do is he will challenge your appetites. Because you can try to stop something by your will, but you will not succeed, because to do something by your will, you have to go under the law. The only way to get rid of that which holds you back is to have your appetite changed. There must be a change in appetite. And the change in appetite comes through suffering. Now, me, I don't like liver. I've never liked beef liver. You know, they bring it out there. It doesn't smell right. It doesn't look right. The one time I tasted it, it didn't taste right. I mean, I've never been at home and said, honey, let's get us some liver cooked up tonight. Because I don't have an acquired taste for liver. Because it has an acquired taste. Some people don't like raw oysters. It literally, they can't even look at them, let alone eat them. Because it has an acquired taste to it. Are you following me? You have to get an acquired taste for the kingdom. You cannot keep your carnal appetites and enter the kingdom and mature. You've got to let your appetite be changed. And God uses suffering to change your appetite. But when he's trying to change our appetite, we go back to consume what we already know rather than acquire a new appetite. I'm trying to preach up in you. And so we start to deal with the way this woman sees her life and the way God sees her life. Now, Jesus is a probing and prying prophet. Jesus just doesn't want to hear, I believe you're the Son of God, now can I go to heaven? He wants to know everything you got covered up. That's why confession is one of the sacraments of the church. Until you get out what is hidden, you cannot move on and get a new appetite. Because you'll always go back to relief for what you're familiar with. You'll look for love in carnal places. You'll look to have your appetite satisfied in carnal places. This story is phenomenal because here's a woman that Jesus shouldn't have even been talking to. And it all started with him asking her a question. Give me a drink. Or as commanding her, give me a drink. And she said, you don't even have anything to pull water with. Because she's so naturally focused. Are you following? But he said, you know what? I have water that you don't have to dip in a well for. See, you can go quite a while without food, but, you know, one of my favorite movies is TV programs is where they go on these 21-day deals and they don't eat or drink, naked and afraid. Yeah, I watch it because I see what thirst does to a person. When somebody's thirsty, it changes all their priorities. They'll start eating and drinking something they would never eat and drink before. I mean, they'll take a chance. It might be contaminated, but I'm so thirsty, I got to have something. So thirst and appetite reveals a lot about us. In the Western approach to Christianity, which is rooted in self-interest agendas, we ask the church questions like, what can my faith do for me? What can the church do for me? What are the benefits of my commitment to obedience and obedience? In looking at this story, we must focus on the Christ perception, the things he saw the woman did not see. The church is the incarnation of Christ. So when you come into the life of the church, there's going to be some probing and prying. The true church, because there's discipleship. And you can't hide issues in discipleship. You're going to have to start unveiling and revealing in the presence of Christ your hang-ups. And Jesus went right for it. The first thing he started to deal with was, call your husband. She says, I don't have a husband. He said, you're right, because you got five men you've lived with, and the man you're living with now is not your husband. You're trying to get your thirst quenched in the wrong way. You're not looking for refreshment from the spirit. You're looking for refreshment from the natural. The church teaches us to boast in our sufferings for the very reason that it glorifies God when we do not trust carnality for our fulfillment anymore. The body has been given the power to manifest the mysteries, as flawed as she is. The presence of Christ will always probe and pry and unveil. That's why entertainment churches work, because there's no probing and prying. If I can go into a big mass of people, have good music, smoke machines, lights, sound, and action, and camera, I don't have to be probed. But when you get into the true church, there's going to be some probing and prying that unveils and reveals some things that we have become accustomed to trusting that are carnal. I'm not going to preach long today. So let's boast for a moment. What should we boast in? Our sufferings, knowing that our sufferings produce endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. You know why most people are hopeless? They won't let their character be developed. Manhood dreams with boyhood issues. Big girl dreams with little girl issues. They won't let their character be developed. And so if your character's never developed, you will never have hope, because character allows you to endure long enough to see what hope really is. When somebody tells me I'm hopeless, I don't know what to do, it's because God is still trying to build your character. And your character means that you learn to do what you have to do, not what you want to do. I'm going to say that again. Character means that I learn to be faithful to what I have to do, not to what I want to do. A little boy does what he wants to do. A man does what he has to do. A little girl does what she wants to do. A grown woman does what she has to do. Character says, I will do what I have to do before I pursue what I want to do. And that is how character produces hope. Because when you're trying to fill your life with toys and games and playing around and not taking responsibility for what you have to do, you'll pursue what you want to do, and then you'll be hopeless. Your hopelessness is not a state of your emotions. It's a state of a lack of character. It's a state of a lack of endurance. Acquired taste. You need to get an acquired taste for doing what you have to do instead of always eating what you want to do. But we've raised a generation that feels entitled to have what they want. You know what poverty is? It's spending money on experiences and not on necessities. Poverty is not sitting on the corner downtown with eating off of the street. It's spending all your resources to try to fulfill yourself in an experience and never investing in the necessities of what you have to do, not what you want to do. And that is the character of God. That's what brings glory to God. Jesus went to the cross because he said, I have meat you know not of. My meat is to do and to finish. My meat is to do the will of God and finish his work. We are raising up a generation of non-finishers. They start something and they won't finish it because they have no character, because their appetites are for what they want, not for what they should do. And then we reward children for what they should do. And we reward everybody for participation and give them a trophy for having fun rather than giving them a trophy for doing what they have to do and finishing it. But the church cannot compromise. The church cannot compromise these truths, because we must worship him in spirit and truth. When you get into a good mentorship position, you submit yourself to the wisdom of another who will not let you quit. When you try to quit, they'll knock on your door and say, you're not quitting. You're not doing that. Because I know What you need is beyond what you want. But we want the church to be a candy store or one of those, you know, yogurt places where you get to walk down the line and decide which flavor you like. And maybe I'll mix a couple of them at Menchie's. I'll get a little bit of pistachio and put a little bit of, you know, tres leche or something on it, or dulce leche or whatever it is. I did that one day and I took two bites and threw it away. I said, this is too sweet for my appetite. I can't take it. Are you following me? You don't get to pick and choose your test. God chooses our test. Amen? So we have the Eucharist, which is the body and blood of God, which we have no life in us if we do not come to the mystery of the church and its flawed members and receive from the church its ability to change bread to flesh and wine to blood so we can put the life of God in us so we have the strength to endure. The enemy, let me tell you what the enemy wants. He wants you so disillusioned you'll walk away from the flesh and blood of Jesus. He's working overtime to get you discouraged so you'll stay away from the only thing that gives you life. I'm talking to the people there. I know some of you live on videos and tapes and all these preachers, but there's no life in this message or that message. There's only life in what comes off that table right there. And the enemy wants to keep you as far away from that table, which means he wants to keep you away from the life of the church because only the church can produce what's on that table. So the devil doesn't care what drug you're doing. He doesn't care what boyfriend or girlfriend you're sleeping with. I know that shocks some of you. He cares about whether you're getting life in you or not. Because if you get the life in you, this food will change your appetite. And then you won't have to try to stop something by your will. Your appetite will change. I would much rather pursue something because I have an appetite for it, not because I'm trying to exercise my will to stop it. Because your will fail if you do not connect it to the source of God Himself. It isn't what you believe, it's what you're connected to. Baptism connects us to the life of the church. This tub right here, this water, is the connecting agent. This is the plug. This is where you get plugged into the life of the church. Here you die to you and you come alive to Christ. That's why on Pascha Sunday we baptize. I don't care how much faith you have, how much you read the Bible, how much praying you do. If you're not plugged in, you have no life in you. Because from here, we go to forgiveness. Or we go to chrismation and forgiveness. Then we go to that table. That exists because of that right there. The body and blood exist because the baptism waters exist. And so there's an assault against church. I'm not religious, I'm spiritual. It means I'm not committed to what I have to do, I just do what I want to do. That's what that means. I'm not committed to anything or anybody but my own self-interests, how I feel, what I think, my history. You don't know what I've been through. What you've been through was ordained by God to get you to the place you could boast in your sufferings. You can say, here's my testimony. Amen? The church was never designed to be a mass of people. The best Jesus could do is gather 12 or 70 around him. Because he was training their character and changing their appetites. The question in Exodus, when the people got mad at Moses, and some of you get mad at me when I preach because you walk out and say, Bishop's targeting me. Yes, I am. That's my job, is to probe and pry. Where did we ever get an idea? Well, let's just keep it general for everybody. We don't want it to get too deep on anybody. No, the job of the presence of Christ is to probe and pry into your life so that you can get free from the thing that's holding you back and you can move to what you have to do instead of being controlled by what you want to do. I know that's a great, you know, that's a mantra to raising your children. I know you don't want to do this, but you have to do this. I'm not going to always gravitate to what you want to do. You don't always get to do what you want to do until you learn what you have to do. Okay, now I'm becoming redundant. But we need to do what we have to do. So we're not controlled by what we want to do, because what we want to do will always speak to our emotions and our appetites. Amen? Okay. All right. Stand to your feet this morning. I don't know what more I can say to you. Other than in conclusion, some of us want God's favor more than we want God's process to change our appetites. Beloved, I'm here today to tell you your testing is the most beautiful part of your Christian walk. When you can learn to say, I'm being tested, because my hunger reveals my appetites and my thirst reveals my beliefs. What I'm thirsty for reveals what I believe, and what I'm hungry for reveals my appetite. Please continue on the 40 days of decrease. Please don't back away from it, because it's there to unlock the things that have been holding you back. It's there to extract the carnality, that you may drink of the waters of living life and not just be dependent on having to go back to natural things over and over to try to survive. Father, I thank you for today. I thank you today, Lord, that we are a community called to press on, press in, and press on to the high calling of God in Christ. Probe us, pry us, search us, see if there be any wicked thing in me, Lord. Is there any wicked thing in us that is controlled by self-interest, immature, emotional paradigms and beliefs, that we may become truly sons and daughters of Christ, that our homes may be filled with peace and stability, that our children would grow up to represent the kingdom from generation to generation, and that we would hear the only words that matter to us when we depart from this world, and that is, well done, good and faithful servant. I bless you all now to go in peace in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now profess our faith in Almighty God. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of